The professional learning community team you will see in this video is composed of high school teachers from various content areas who will be collaboratively unpacking the 9th grade English language arts standards for writing. It's important that teachers work together to unpack the standards into clear, specific, student-friendly learning objectives. This is the first step that is connected to daily classroom practice. When teachers across content areas or a grade level have a common understanding of what the standards mean, then they have common expectations for what students should know, understand, and be able to do. This is how we begin a continuous cycle of improvement and raise the achievement levels of all students. Let's watch how these high school teachers do that.
So, how's everyone doing?
Pretty good.
Well, pretty good. How
are you?
We're almost finished with the 9th grade standards so far. So it's been really tough, but as we go along, I think we're getting better. So let's just quickly go over the norms. So we're going to honor our start and our end times. We're going to keep to our objective, and I'll state that in a second. Remember to actively listen and participate. If you have concern, remember to respond positively, not negatively, and don't judge. Also, make sure to address violations of the norms. So if someone's being negative, just politely call them on it, bring them back. And remember that we're here to think, reflect, and puzzle about things, so we don't want to be going too fast. As you guys know, over the past few years, we've been using textbooks, programs to drive the curriculum, and the alignment to the standards isn't always there. This also means that, of course, our assessments are not always standard aligned, and so if we want to improve student learning, we all need to be on the same page, we all need to be, you know, working from the same playbook. At our last professional learning community meeting, we began unpacking the writing standards for grades 9 and 10. So let's pick up where we left off in text types and purposes, which is standard number 2. We copied them from the standard documents, and we stuck them in this developing the curriculum template. So we can do this on paper, but it would be easier if we did that online. So did you all get the Google Doc link I sent you?
We did.
Yeah, we did.
Okay, excellent. So today we're going to use the same process that we did the last time. After we've gone through the steps of unpacking the standards on the paper template, we're going to record our work on the Google Doc, which will give us a big picture of what we want students to learn. And that'll make it easier when we begin clustering our student learning objectives into the units that we've already set up. All right, so we've got our unpacking templates out. And it's worked really well in the past when each of us has taken the lead in guiding our discussion. So can I get a volunteer to start?
I can go first.
OK.
The standard 2 states, write informative explanatory texts to examine and convey complex ideas, concept, and information clearly and accurately through the effective selection, organization, and analysis of content.
We're going to first underline the nouns, because these are
right.
Obviously the important what's in the text. Topic, sentences, for example, ideas, concepts. So for section A, would someone like to start on the underlining of nouns?
Underline concepts and information.
Information, right?
Yeah, I'd go for connections and
distinctions.
Graphics,
multimedia.
Okay, so let's circle the verbs. We're doing this because we want to focus on what we actually want the students to do.
Right.
And a verb is basically the action we want the students to undertake here.
Right, so.
So, yeah.
We would circle introduce,
yep.
Organize, make.
Aiding.
Good, yes.
And so with each noun, we should really have a verb as to what the students are doing with that information.
Okay.
So, I would say aiding with the formatting, graphics, and multimedia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, do we go from here? Do we go and do the student learning objective for part A, or do we go?
Yeah, so we want to make a student-friendly learning objective.
Okay.
Why don't we take a look at the DOK thing here? Because that also gives us our...
The depth of knowledge?
Yeah, the blue.
I think for me, the way I understand introduced a topic is basically to bring in the topic, which topic of a topic they have to learn about, to bring it in any way or form that will help them kind of understand it right away, and then how to organize ideas within that topic.
I would think maybe level 2 with organizing what you need to put in that beginning part there, introducing and maybe categorizing what goes in what body paragraph.
Yeah, and to some extent summarize too.
I would put that as maybe the who, what, where, when, and why of the piece
would go to level 1, but then level 2, the summarizing and organizing.
And then make important connections and distinctions is definitely a level, let's see, that one's 2 and 3, I'd say.
Well, connect is a level 4 word.
Yeah, and I'm looking for level three here for
construct.
Construct is level three.
So it would be three and four.
Yeah, three and four. Yeah. So if we're going to make a student learning objective, we're going to try to use what they call a WALT. Mm-hmm. We are learning to, or we are learning that. So it's from the student's point of view, what are they learning? Okay, why don't we start from the top of A?
Yeah, for example, for me, the way I see it, it's like every verb we have here is actually giving it a WALT.
A different WALT.
Yeah, so WALT one would be to introduce a topic.
So I'll do, we are learning to introduce topics for...
For a type of writing, not just any writing.
For a text that explains it or gives information about it.
Okay.
That sounds good.
Okay, so I've got, we are learning to introduce topics for an informational / explanatory text.
Okay.
All right, we've finished A. Good job, everyone. Next problem is, how do we know they've done it?
What evidence do we have?
And we need evidence to, you know.
So okay. If the first thing that we are going to do is introduce topics, then what is the evidence of that? We can write a topic sentence.
Topic sentence would be good, or topic sentence like we will explain, or yes.
Okay, so.
Can write a thesis statement. Number two, organize complex ideas, which means what? We can organize complex ideas.
Using a graphic organizer.
Yeah. So we finished packing all the ninth grade English and Language Arts standards. So our next step is to actually cluster the standards and the student learning objectives into the actual units of study. We need to remember two things. One is you only really want to put one of these into the unit where it's specifically going to be taught.
Right.
Two, if they're having trouble with it, feel free to put it into the next unit or into, you know, so that you reteach it to them later. I've got the Google Doc up here. For each unit, I'm going to put the learning objectives that each goes into, that we've broken it down. If you look at the Google Doc, I highlighted a couple things that I thought might be clustered, but again, for you guys, they might not be clustered. So if you have like five units, where would you put your organization versus, say, thesis statement? So
I'll go first.
So if we're going to cluster them, then we might put three and four
together
for A in unit one. Do you guys hit like MLA formatting first? Because I know I hit it in my second unit usually.
Right, it was definitely a big challenge, but we did use it in the end.
Where would you put it?
Right before finishing. Once you get all the information all put together, now this is how...
Right, well, in MLA.
It's part of like organizing. Once you like get all the information, this is how we're going to organize it using this way. And that's
right, the
how
formatting,
we
the headings, right. The...
Yeah,
unit five maybe.
That would be five.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know, I know we're all going to be assessing this, like, as the year goes on, whatever was taught in unit one is going to be assessed a bit in unit two, three,
and four.
And by unit five, they should know it and they should be doing it automatically.
Right.
But the units where we specifically teach it is the only one where we're actually going to put it in the curriculum. Otherwise, it gets so overwhelmingly big and confusing that we can't even teach from it. I know I've enjoyed this. How did you guys think we did today?
I think we did great.
I think we did very good.
Yeah, I thought we worked really well together. I really enjoyed the fact that we stayed to the norms, and so we kept it very non-judgmental and very positive.
Good job.
Okay. Well, thank you.
So thanks.
All right.
Good job, everyone, and thank you.
In the video we just saw, I want to note the importance of having a viable, standards-based curriculum that is the foundation of the instructional process. Curriculum should be collaboratively developed and directly connected to daily classroom practice. If a curriculum is going to be viable, it needs to be reflected on and revised regularly by the PLC teams. Once teachers have unpacked the standards into clear, specific, student-friendly learning objectives, the hardest work is completed. The skeleton of the curriculum is established, and the teachers work together to build the rest of the pieces. The work of the teachers is captured into the unit template and in their future PLC conversations. Then the remaining pieces of the curriculum are added. These include essential questions, instructional activities, resources, and assessments. If we are to improve the learning of all students, there must be tight alignment across all pieces of the instructional process, beginning with the curriculum and continuing with formative and summative assessments and instructional experiences. Unpacking the standards collaboratively is a powerful professional learning experience that improves both teacher practice and student learning.